seen the risen sun awakening the early dawn, rising up to give you the praise. But we have seen the stars and moons, how they shine for you, calling us to do the same. So we rise up with song.
Yeah. Join me in the call to worship. God of our ancestors and God of our dreams, we gather today to remember that you have created us all in your image and in your likeness.
And so we still have the courage to dream the impossible.
We remember how you spoke into the darkness and created light.
And so we still have the courage to dream the impossible.
We remember the ways that you have delivered your people through trials and tribulations since the beginning of time, right up until this present moment.
And so we still have the courage to dream the impossible.
You have comforted us through the middle passage, racism, segregation, strict identities, and unjust laws.
And so we still have the courage to dream the impossible.
God, you have been the guiding light along the paths of hope and love, leading it towards a beloved community where all are equally seen and radically loved.
And so we still have the courage to dream the impossible.
Proclaim the glory of your name.
as broken creatures have fallen short of all that has been required of us. Whereas you looked at your beloved creation and you said, it is good. We have at times looked at that same creation and rejected its beauty and inherent goodness. We have looked at the color of one another's skin and assigned beauty and worth based on its hue. We have felt the texture of one another's hair and determined what is good and what is damaged. We have examined one another's frame and labeled it as human or other. We have fallen short of being family and each other's keeper, but
deep in my heart, I do believe that we shall overcome someday.
We have ignored the cries of others as they seek justice from the oppressor, and we told them to wait a little while longer. We have hidden the wounds of the ghettos of our society in an attempt to showcase society's beauty in the world. We have not fed the hungry, given drink to the thirsty, or shelter to the stranger because of how they looked or the inconvenience of their need. But
deep in my heart, I do believe the truth shall make us free someday.
But today is a new day, full of opportunities to try again. What was left undone yesterday can be completed today. We can turn from the sins of neglect and dishonesty and prayerfully move towards reconciliation and mutual respect. The realization that we are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny, whatever affects one directly, affects all indirectly. And it forces me to be concerned about what happens to my neighbor. And so,
oh, deep in my heart, I do believe we shall live in peace someday.
Would you just take a moment and take a deep breath and think about that day that is coming? Today we proclaim to the people of the United States of America and to the nations of the world that we are not about to turn around.
We are on the move now.
Yes, we are on the move and no wave of racism can stop us.
We are on the move now.
The burning of our churches will not deter us. The bombing of our homes will not dissuade us.
We are on the move now.
Like an idea whose time has come, not even the marching of mighty armies can halt us.
We are on the move now.
And we are on the move because the Spirit of the Lord is upon us to preach good tidings to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound.
We are on the move, and we thank you, our God, for going with us.
Last week we watched a video by a friend of mine, Richard Brooksford Colligan. These videos actually are the inspiration for this worship series. They were a part of a family toolkit put out by the Minnesota Conference for families who haven't been able to come to church or to Sunday school so that they could take a look at just thinking about a few bits, especially of the Psalms. Richard loves the Psalms. And so I hope you will enjoy today's video and listen to Richard's wonder and sing along with Richard's wonderful song.
That would really well. They know they were taken care of at that time. They felt courage in the midst of a troubling situation. Though I walk through trouble, you've got me. Wow, that sounds really confident, doesn't it? Maybe because of remembering what's gone well in the past, the writer feels good about today. My life is in your hands, and your love never fails. Those are words of deep trust, don't you think? Where am I in the midst of the unknown? In the midst of trouble? In the midst of feeling a little uneasy or even scared? I think I'm right in your hands, God, no matter what. Your love never fails. And the very last line, good God, never let go of me. Seems like the psalmist has been through some things. And this little prayer at the end has a different tone, doesn't it? It sounds a little different than the gratitude and thankfulness of the first part, and a little different than the confident trust of the second part. This sounds like, I wonder if the psalmist is feeling a little bit scared or nervous about the unknown right now. Sometimes that's a good prayer to pray. God, don't leave me. I'm so glad that a song like this from our past has these three very different movements in it. There's wonder in being grateful. There's wonder in feeling confident and trusting. And there's wonder in needing to ask for help. Oh, let's sing a song for Psalm 138. This song is called Walking Through Trouble. You might be thinking, oh, I'm out of trouble right now. That's okay. Let's sing it for those who are. Your part goes like this.
Trouble.
of awe or wonder have I experienced? And number three, what does it feel like to trust God? I hope you enjoy this week of practicing wonder. Enjoy this week's toolkit. I'll see you next time.
We continue with another story of wonder in Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in, behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. And if I take the wings of the morning and settle all at the farthest limits of the sea, even there, your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light around me become night, even the darkness is not dark to you, and the night is as bright as the day. The darkness is as light to you. For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works that I know very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my uniform substance. If your book were written, all the days that were formed for me, when none of them has yet existed. How weighty to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them.
Monday, we will once again take time out in our nation to honor the hard and dedicated work of the Reverend Martin Luther King, Jr. We will honor his call to faithfulness. We will honor his encouragement to stand for equal rights for every American and to stand in a peaceful defiance against the powers who would try to deny people those rights. Of course, Martin Luther King Jr. is most well known for his struggle against racial inequality. Many people don't know that he also wrote great deals about our entire economic system and the ways it kept people poor. I would say it keeps poor people poor while increasing the wealth of those who need it the most. We like to think that we have come such a long way since Martin marched. We want so desperately to believe that we have fixed things, that life is better. We need only look at the past year's conflicts to know that we have not healed the great divides over race in our nation. Yes, we may have made progress officially, or in small ways politically and societally about the way we consciously think about race and equality. But somewhere, deep under the surface, that wound has been festering, breaking out time and time again and calling for the need for the deep cleansing, healing of truth-telling and repentance and reconciliation. We've too often thought of racism as a surface wound in the body of American life, but it is so much deeper and all-encompassing than we have known or wanted to acknowledge. Many of us, until recently, were unaware of the ways that laws were twisted to keep power with white landowners in the South and imprison black men so they could still be forced to work without pay. Many of us, until recently, were unaware of some of the power plays and attempted starvation tactics of the so-called Indian agents that drove Native groups to fight. So we looked at what seemed to be a simple problem and tried to address only those little portions of an extremely complex history. But every time we think we've fixed one thing, another layer just shows itself to be unhealed. This year, after a year of protests against the disproportionate violence against Black, Indigenous, and people of color in our nation, a rise of white supremacist groups, will we finally ask ourselves what's deep at the bottom of that wound that still needs to be healed? Will we stop telling ourselves to just get over it and move on? As if we can do that when the trust is non-existent right now. Will we learn our whole history, not just the parts most of us learned in school, so that we can truly make amends for the past and learn what remnants of process still favor some and oppress others? Will we be able to look honestly at our economic system and admit that it too often serves people with power and wealth when we, with limited power and wealth, focus our mistrust against one another? I know. What does this have to do with today's theme? What does it have to do with wonder? I love the part of Richard's video where he says that we like to be smart. We like to believe that we are worldly. Our whole upbringing has told us that we need to be the one of the smart ones in order to get ahead. And as a result, on the surface at least, we certainly don't want to admit to anyone that we don't know something. No matter what we're feeling on the inside, what insecurities we're carrying, we're not going to admit it to the rest of the world. So when we're confronted with information that expands upon, or God forbid, contradicts what we think we know, too often our first reaction is to shut down, contradict, get defensive. And then there's that real part of who we are as humans. You will hear psychologists and psychiatrists talk about it.
that instinct
to protect ourselves from the unknown. We who have been surrounded by books and movies and television programs for our entire lives have been reading and watching subtle messages about how life works. And most of those messages have come through the lens of white, male, heteronormative life. So sometimes, without even realizing it, we find anything else frightening. And we choose our defense mode, fight or flee or freeze. So imagine, if you can, that each time we experience that moment of fear, that adrenaline rush, that moment of challenge, we could just stop ourselves. And instead of reacting out of fear, we could choose a place of wonder. I wonder if they know something that we don't know. I wonder what experiences they have been through that would have led to that way of thinking. I wonder if there is a deep wound that is bursting from them right now. I wonder if there is a deep wound causing me to lash out. I wonder if that person's way of living might actually be a more holistic, healthier way of living than the traditions with which I've been raised. I wonder if all that anger comes from a lifetime of struggle. I wonder if I may have done something, even inadvertently, that has added to the injustice this person has lived. Listen again, listen carefully, listen deeply to these words. For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, that I know very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Now more than ever, it is vital that we believe these words, not just on the surface or not just in our minds, but to our very core. It's vital that we claim the hand of God as our creator and believe that all God's works are indeed wonderful. Because when we know we belong to God, when we know that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, there is no need to prove we are right, or prove ourselves better than someone else, or prove that our way is the only way. When we know we belong to God, we needn't worry about what anyone else thinks of us. And it is vital that we recognize these words as descriptive of every neighbor and of all of creation. It's vital that we claim the hand of God as our neighbor's creator and believe that all God's works are indeed wonderful. Because when we know our neighbor belongs to God, when we know that they are fearfully and wonderfully made, there is no need to prove them wrong or prove them to be lesser than we, or prove that their way of being in the world is not the way to be in the world. When we know that they belong to God, we needn't allow ourselves to be told by anyone what we should think of them. Now, please don't hear me wrong. This does not mean that we just find another kumbaya moment that takes us right back to a new surface healing. This does not mean that we don't stand firmly against injustice when we see it, when we recognize it. And it doesn't mean that we don't side with the oppressed. And it certainly does not mean we don't work as diligently as we can to bring justice and healing to this world. What it means is that we first look beyond our own fears and our own assumptions and our own need for power and control so that we can truly recognize a way forward together. All children of the one true God, honored and loved, and most importantly, led by the God who created us all. Amen.
Almighty God, when I survey
Would you pause? Take a deep breath. Breathe in all of the Spirit of God that is around you. Take it into your being and let it cascade through your soul. And spend just a few moments in silent prayer. Creator God, we are anxious. Some of us are frightened, puzzled, calm, happy, sad. We are coming today with every emotion that is the palette of human existence. The continued stresses in our nation affect us. The conflicts in our families affect us. The long separation, trying not to spread this virus, affects us. And if we let it, it all drags us down into a deep pit. And then we remember the past. We remember your faithfulness. We remember the struggles that our ancestors have come through before this day. Remember all of those little joys in our life, and all of a sudden we can see the benefits even of this time in history. We see how someone created this wonderful thing called the internet that allows us to stay connected with one another, even when we're trying to keep one another safe. We recognize the new ways of being in the world that just might be better than what we were doing before. We give thanks for time with families. New opportunities to learn together and grow together without rushing off to be here and there. It's all amazing to us. And so we come before you with that deep wonder and give you thanks. And call upon your presence from this day forward. Hear us now as we pray together the words that Jesus himself taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'm so glad that you were able to worship with us today. We have a few announcements, things that are going on in the life of this church. We have our morning Tai Chi classes, our Wednesday Tai Chi classes, our meditation classes, our book studies, All of that is found on our website. I'm not going to go through it here. But if you would like to join us for some Zoom events, just go to newjerseyucc.org. Or you can find us also on Facebook. I will say that if you are intrigued by Richard's work, he also has a new Sunday Psalm event that he's doing, and I will try to find that that website and put that information also on our Facebook page and website, so that you can follow his psalm work. Are there any announcements that I have missed?
Yes.
January 24th, next Sunday, we are encouraging as many people as possible to join us by Zoom, because right after worship, we will hold our annual meeting. If you have not been able to get on Zoom, if you are not an internet user, please give the office a call, because there is also a way to telephone into that meeting so that you can participate as well. We would love to have as many as possible from our congregation to be there for our annual meeting on the 24th, right after worship. So, if there are no other announcements, let's sing. Encouraging you and guiding you on your way. So take the heart of Christ with you as you leave this worship, that all will know God's love and God's faithfulness. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be with you this day.